Hello all, this is Sushant from Skill to Hire. So I welcome all the participants for this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So actually the thing is we are only streaming this on YouTube. We are not hosting this session from Zoom. So please associate partners and also the participants, let your friends know so that they'll join this live stream. We are only streaming this on YouTube. Don't try joining the session from our Skill to Hire platform. Just use this link, share this link with your friends and with your colleagues. So do this as soon as possible. So actually there was some technical issue with that Zoom, so we shifted that to YouTube streaming. So please do share this link with your friends who might be facing problem during joining the session from our Skill to Hire platform. So make sure to share this link with your friends and with the co-participants that you know. Meanwhile, branding partners, please share this link also with your participants, with the registered participants, so that they can also join the session as soon as possible. Yesterday, the count was more than 100, and 200 participants were in the waiting room in yesterday's session. So due to some reasons, yesterday's session got canceled. So I hope the strength will continue, like same 300 participants will be also attending today's session. So for that purpose, you people have to help us with this. Please share this link with the with your friends, with your colleagues who have registered for this workshop. And we have also sent the mail to all the registered participants. We have sent this link to their mails to all the registered participants. We have sent this particular video link, streaming link. So I hope that have reached to all the participants. You please let your friends know regarding this. And I once again welcome all the participants who have joined till now to this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So we have to wait for a few minutes so that other participants can also join. And also I request the branding partners to share this link with the participants and also tell them to join as soon as possible, because we have to start the session. So there are only 42 people watching now. So yesterday the count was quite high. Due to some technical issues with Zoom, right, we have shifted ourselves to YouTube streaming. I hope you people understand. And also the recordings will be available on YouTube. You can also access the this video after the live streaming is done. We will be posting this once the live streaming is done also. So you need not worry about the recordings too. But our only request is share this with the registered participants, with your friends, with your colleagues who have registered for this particular workshop, as soon as possible, because our resource person is also waiting. So today is day one session of blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. Tomorrow the day two will be conducted, and also day three will be on day after tomorrow. So there is a slight change in timetable, as I have told you yesterday. So generally this entire workshop was scheduled on 26th, 27th and 28th, but we rescheduled it to 27th, 28th and 29th. And the other two sessions, that is tomorrow and day after tomorrow, also we'll be streaming this on YouTube only. We will not be going with Zoom. So be updated with our YouTube channel. So do subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you can get instant notification when we stream this live on YouTube. Our sincere thanks to all the associate partners of this particular 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So our associate partners for this workshop are School of Computers IPS Academy, Malla Reddy Engineering College, Hyderabad, Sri Manakula Vinayagar Engineering College, Vignana Bharati Institute of Technology, Nanda Engineering College. So our sincere thanks to all the associate partners for this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. And also my sincere, I welcome all the participants to this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. Actually, we are waiting for the participants to join this session. So meanwhile, participants, please let me know in the chat box whether my voice is clear or not, and also let me know whether the screen is visible or not. Type yes if you can see the screen clearly and also if you can hear the voice clearly. Yes, okay, thank you. Hello all, this is Sushant from Skill to Hire. I once again welcome all the participants to this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So I think we have to wait for a few more minutes so that other participants can also join. The count is quite less. So I think this link has not reached yet. So meanwhile, I request the participants and also the branding partners to share the link as soon as possible. Share this with the registered participants, like your friends and your colleagues. So, and even during the session, if you face any problems with the audio or with the video, right, that is the screen, you can just let us know in the chat box. Once again, I sincerely thank our associate partners for this 3-day workshop. So our associate partners for this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals are School of Computers IPS Academy, Malla Reddy Engineering College, Sri Manakula Vinayagar Engineering College, Vignana Bharati Institute of Technology, Nanda Engineering College. So, and my sincere thanks to all the participants that have joined us today for this day one session on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So please be patient for a few more minutes so that the other participants can also join. So within 2 minutes, I'll hand over the session to this workshop resource person. So meanwhile, you can just help your friends join this session live on YouTube. You cannot join this session from our Skill2Hire platform because from Skill2Hire platform you can only join to Zoom. So whereas we are facing some problems with that Zoom, there is some technical issues with that. So please let your friends know and tell them to join from this YouTube link. Share this YouTube link and also make sure to subscribe our YouTube channel so that in the tomorrow and day after tomorrow session you'll get the updates. Once again, I welcome all the participants and our associate partners for this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. So, our blockchain team lead Kaushik will be taking this session for these 3 days. So, yes, Kaushik, you can take over from here.
Yes, Sushant, can you hear me?
Yes, Kaushik, yes, you're audible.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, everything is fine.
Yeah, I think we can wait for other 3 minutes, right? So other participants will join.
Yes.
Hello, is my voice clear now? Somebody are saying my voice is not clear. If it is clear, please reply in the chat box. Okay. Yes. I see some. Yeah, yeah. Okay, fine. Yeah, we will start the session in another 2 minutes. So please be patient. Please share the YouTube link to your friends and colleagues so they can join the session. So there are only 81 members, right? So I'm going to wait another 3 minutes. If you have any queries, you can post in the chat. Is it now clear? My voice is clear now, sir. So, Srinivas Reddy sir is telling that he is getting some reason. Can you hear my voice now?
Yes, Kaushik, yes, we can hear you. You can just proceed.
Yes, yes, give me 1 second. Yes, yeah, all of some say how many noise is coming. Yeah, I think I got so many SS. So I will proceed with this. So hello all, I am Kaushik Delhi from Skill to Hire. I will be the mentor of this 3-day workshop on Introduction to Blockchain Technology. Okay, voice is fine, please. Okay. Yes. So this is the day one of the workshop. So on day one, we will discuss about what is blockchain technology and I will give you a brief overview of what this technology and how this technology works, why it is so important to know this technology. So on day two, we will discuss about Bitcoin and how cryptocurrencies work. So on day three, we will discuss about cryptocurrencies, transactions, and how transactions in cryptocurrencies work when compared to other banking sectors. And we will see how cryptocurrency wallet works and how to use a wallet. So during the session, you can post any of your queries in the chat box. So please don't hesitate to ask your queries. So if you're stuck in the middle, I can't help you if you didn't ask any query. So I will start within 2 minutes. So I hope there are enough participants, so I don't waste any of your time. So let's start the session. So once again, for the new participants, I am Kaushik Delhi from Skill to Hire. I will be the mentor of this 3-day workshop on introduction to blockchain technology. On day one, we will discuss about blockchain technology, and I will give you a brief overview of what this technology is and how it works. On day two, we will see about how Bitcoin works and how other cryptocurrencies work. So on day three, we will see about how cryptocurrency transactions work when compared to banking sector, and we will see about how wallets work, and I will show you a demo with how to use a wallet. So I think all of you know blockchain is a cutting edge technology in the industry right now, right? So many job offerings in this technology space, even when compared to artificial intelligence and machine learning. There are so many job hirings in LinkedIn in this technology, so because there are so many less people knowing about this technology. So there is so much demand in this market. So it is best time now to step and learn about this technology. So if you think you are late, that's totally wrong. You are very, very early for this technology. So I hope there are enough participants. So please share the YouTube link to your friends and colleagues. There are only 88 participants, but I am going to start the session. It is already 6:20, right? Yes. Can everyone hear me? I want a response, and I will start the session.
Yes, Kaushik, your voice is clear and also your screen is also clear. So you can just proceed with the session.
Okay. So this is our day one agenda. So first we will see what is blockchain. We will talk about SHA-256 hash function. So we will see how this hash function is used to form an immutable ledger. So there are participants coming. Okay. So we will see how P2P networks work, and we will see about mining concept, how Bitcoin mining works. So we will see a concept called Byzantine fault tolerance, which is used in many distributed networks and distributed systems. So we will talk about blockchain consensus protocol, and at last I will give you a simple blockchain demo, what we discussed, and I will show you a web-based tool to show how blockchain works and what we do in live. So let's start. So what is blockchain exactly? So if you go and search in Wikipedia, we will get this definition. A blockchain is a growing list of records called blocks that are linked using linked and secured using cryptography. So what are these blocks and what are these cryptographic links, we will see in the next slides. But before, I want to explain you what is by taking an example. So let's say you and your friends are getting together to play a poker game, and one of your friends is supposed to bring poker chips. So but he forgot to bring the poker chips. So you and your friends meet a long time ago, right? So you don't want to cancel the game. So what you did is you decided to change the rules of game. So you came up with a different idea to play the game. To play the game, everyone takes a sheet of paper, and they decided to sign poker chips, and every hand they play, they are going to record on their sheet of paper. So at the end, they can tally their sheets, and everything is fine. They can check at the end of the game. So now think about a friend trying to cheat. So but the point here is everyone has the record, right? So they can easily eliminate the cheater. So the point here is why I'm telling this example is the more accurate the system will be, when will be the this system will be more accurate. So if there are more than two cheaters, and if there are three cheaters, then the game will be spoiled, right? So there should be less cheaters. 1 minute, please. So the point here is more friends we have played the game, the more accurate the system will be, right? So the blockchain technology also works in the similar way. So there is no central authority maintaining all the records or anything data like that. So there will be a distributed system. It is a distributed system. So by this, I think you understand how blockchain works. So everyone has the data. So everyone has the right to answer in this technology. So no central authority can manipulate the results. Let's talk about what are these blocks and cryptographic links. So how a blocks looks like, we will see. I'm going to explain all these in pictorial representations. So in real world, the block doesn't exist, what I showed. It's all entirely code. So for your sake of understanding, I am going to represent all in pictorial representations. So this is a block. It has a data field, a previous hash, and a current hash. It's nothing but it has some data like transfer records like that. So this hash here represents as the fingerprint of this data. We'll talk about this hash more in the future, but basically right now the best way to think about hash is like a fingerprint of some data. So this hash obtains by taking this data field and previous hash and giving to some function, and it gives a unique fingerprint to that block. So the first block in the blockchain is called Genesis block. It has some data, but we are not going to see what data it consists of. but it doesn't have a previous hash because it is the first block, right? So it has its own hash which represents this block. So the hash is like a fingerprint, like for one human we will have a fingerprint, right, representing us. So like blocks also have one fingerprint called hash. Remember like that, we will talk about what that hash is exactly in the next concept. So you can see there are three blocks here, right? The second block has some data. This time it has a previous hash, which is the hash of the Genesis block, and it has its own hash, right? So you can see here there is a link between these two blocks, right? So this is the cryptographic link we have seen in the definition. So if this block changes, data in this block changes, so it means think of it as a person. The person changes means the fingerprint. So the link, this block has this previous person's fingerprint. So the link here will be broken. They are linked like this. If you are a computer science student, you may have studied about linked list, right? So it's basically a big linked list. Just imagine it's basically a big linked list. But here they are linked with a cryptographic hash link. So I think you got a basic idea of what fields a block contains and how a block blockchain link will form, right? So please give me a response in chat box if you understand that. So Answara says no. See, this is a block and it has mainly three fields. I am not telling all the fields. Yeah, it has mainly fields. It has a data field, it has a previous hash, it has a hash. The hash here represents this block. So it means it's a unique fingerprint, it's a unique identity of this block. So same, the second block also have those three fields. But the second block is linked with the first block with previous hash field. You can see this previous hash field, right? So it contains 0, 3, 4, DFA, 3, 5, which is the hash of this block, 0, 3, 4, DFA, 3, 5, 7. So basically these are linked. This is a cryptography hash. We will talk about that. So they are linked using a cryptographic link. So that's what we have seen in the definition, right? So we will talk about more on this session, but I think you got a basic idea of what I am telling about the definition and how the blocks are linked using cryptographic link, right? So if yes, comment in the chat box. I will proceed. Yes. Yeah. Let's move. So now let's see what that cryptographic link. We will talk about the concept called SHA-256. The full form is, for SHA is secure hash algorithm. So we will see what role it plays in the blockchain and why we need to learn about this hash function, right? So like every human, I have said before, right? Like every human have a unique fingerprint. So we can generate a fingerprint of a digital document by using this hash algorithm. So the hash algorithm is 256 bit long. Here you can see there are some bunch of digital documents or PDFs, and this is the input of the hash function, and it gives a unique fingerprint representing this digital documents. So you can see here there are 64 characters. Each character represents a byte. So 64 into 64 equal to 256. So the output length will be same in the hash function. So it has 256, it gives 256 bit length output. It gives a fixed length output. So this algorithm not only works for documents, it works for any digital content like video, audio, etc. So at the end everything is bunch of zeros and ones, right? So this hash function do some mathematical calculations. I'm not going to in particular details of what it will do. So we just see what it gives, what input it takes and what output it gives. So that's enough for understanding the function, right? So the main thing is it's a one-way function. So it is not an encryption and decryption algorithm like other cryptographic algorithms like AES and RSA. So this is a hash function, or it is a one-way function. Means you cannot predict the input by seeing the hash. If you take a small PDF and you run this hash algorithm on that, so it gives a unique hash. So and you take this hash and you give to your friend and say you can find PDF, right? Means no, he can't find, because by seeing that hash there is no reverse process to get that PDF document. So it is a main thing to keep in mind. So it is a one-way function, so we cannot predict the input by seeing the output. So you can see we can represent mathematically like this function h of x equal to y, where x is the input data and y is the hash. I think you got a basic understand. We will look a practical demo with this. So if you understand what I have told, please respond in the chat box. Yes, I got. So I will continue. So let's look at a demo in this Andros Brownworth website. We will be visiting this website quite a lot. So let's go to this website. So give me a second, please. I will share that website screen. Give me a second. So you can see my screen, right? Sushant, can you see my screen?
Yes, Kaushal. Yes. Yes, we can see it now.
Yeah.
We can see it now. Yes.
So this is the input field of the hash function, and it gives a unique pixel length output. So let's type something. See, for every letter it the hash of the output hash changes, right? So if I take off this R, the complete hash changes, right? So if you give any type of inputs, let's say I will go to Christopher Nolan. I will copy the entire content. This is a large content, so I'm giving this content. So you can see that the unique hash, right? So So there is a lot of content you can give. There is no limit for the data you can give in the Unique output within seconds. So that's a point to keep in mind. So it is so fast. So you can see here a pull stop, right? I will remove that pull stop. First, remember this hash. It has a 482F5, right? So I'm removing the pull stop. You can see 66F2F, the entirely complete hash changes by removing a. So this chaining of hash we will call as avalanche effect. So a small change in the input gives a dramatic change in the output. So that's how hash functions work. You can play around with this website. Sushant will post the link in the chat box. So in free time you can go around and you can see how you can type anything and you so in free time. So you can play. If you type your name, you will get a unique hash for that. So let's go to session. So these are the five requirements of a hash algorithm. So algorithm to be a hash algorithm, it should follow these five requirements. So then only we will say that that algorithm is a hash algorithm. So as I told, it is a one-way algorithm. We cannot predict the input by seeing the output. So it should be a one-way function. So it should be deterministic. Means you cannot get two different outputs for the same input. So if you take one input here, you run the algorithm in this computer and it gives a hash algorithm hash for that, and you go and run with the other computer with the same input, it should give exactly the same hash. So it should be deterministic. So it should not give different outputs for one input. So as I told, it should be a fast computation. So you are doing it doesn't matter. Within seconds, it gives the unique output, unique length output. So I talked about avalanche effect before. So as we saw in the demo, a small change in the input gives a dramatic change in the output, right? So that is called an avalanche effect. So why that avalanche means, basically in real world, the avalanche effect means a small snowball hill and all the snow will come with that, right? A small snowball. So a small change in the input gives a so dramatic change in the output. So that's why they call this as avalanche effect. So the fifth requirement is it must withstand collisions. So collisions means so for two different inputs it should not get a same hash. So you understood that, right? So if h of z is should not equal to y. So for two different inputs, there should not be one output. So it must withstand collisions. So these five requirements you should keep in the mind. But the main thing you can keep in the mind right now is it's a one-way function. It gives a unique string for any input data. So I hope you all got the how hash function works, right? So if yes, you comment in the chat box. Okay, we will go to next topic. So we will discuss about what is immutable ledger. So we have seen SHA-256 previously. We will see how that SHA-256 can be used as an immutable ledger. So ledger means a list of records, right? So we will see why it is an immutable ledger. So I will tell you an example how immutable ledger works so that you can understand clearly what is an immutable ledger. So let's say you have some money and you want to buy a house. So what you will do usually you go and take the money and give it to the house owner. In return, what the house owner gives to you. So he gives a deed representing you are the owner of that house. So what you both will do, you go and take this deed and you go to a government service like a registration office. You go and register with your name on the deed. So a typical government, let's say, what they will do, they will maintain a ledger. Like you can, they can maintain a database or a ledger where the belongs, this house belongs to you. So they write down there. So they write in a traditional ledger. So many banks still use in so many countries a paper ledger rather than digital documents. So let's think of it's a small database, centralized database. They record your data. So you get your house, you give money to the owner and you buy the house like this way. Let's say a corrupted officer or an attacker changes the ledger, deletes your column that this is your house. An attacker comes and changes this ledger. So meanwhile you are sitting in the house, but you don't have this house, right, officially. So how immutable ledgers handle this situation, how blockchain comes here in this place, right? So let's see. So if when you are buying a house, if you stored in a block rather than a central database or a paper ledger, so you will create a new block, right? So your record will be stored in this block. So let's say you bought a house and this green block represents your transaction. So the block is appended to the ledger. There will be, right, as we saw before. So this chart, this previous hash is in this previous hash column. So there is a link. So let's say after some time happened and there are so many blocks attached to this ledger. Hacker comes and tries to change this ledger. So a corrupted officer or any hacker changes the data in ledger. So what happened is the data in the block changes, right? So the whole hash of, so as we have, remember the avalanche effect, right? So if there is a data, input data changes, the whole output will change, right? So he tries to change this block, but remember the avalanche effect here, the cryptographic link will be broken, right? So this previous hash here in this block, the previous hash column have different value than the current hash of this block. So the cryptographic link will be broken. So what happens is everybody knows something is wrong and our ledger is modified, and they can come and change that ledger to its previous value. So they can, everybody knows that something is happened and somebody is changing the ledger, and they can again regain it. So what the hacker should do to gain complete access? So he should change this block also. So he should change the previous hash of this block. So again this block changes, right? So the link between these two blocks will be broken. So he should change this block also. So like that, he should change the whole ledger. So we are not talking about distributed networks right now, but let's say only this ledger will be there in the centralized database, even if that is. So the hacker should change all the blocks. So he, although he can change, but it does, so somebody is changing and we can go and stop the attack, right? So I hope all of you got an idea of immutable ledger. So means a ledger is a record of transactions, right? So immutable means we cannot tamper with it. So if a hacker tries to tamper with it, the cryptographic link will be broken, which we have seen in the chart of physics. So remember the avalanche effect. So you should change the whole ledger, so which makes a hard task for him, and which gives us a alert message, so something is happening. So we should change we should change all our, we should regain our access. So there is an attacker. So we will get an alert message. So I hope you got an idea of immutable ledger, right? So if yes, comment in the chat box. Okay. Yes, I got a yes. So I will be proceeding. So we will take this immutable ledger concept, and we will see how this immutable ledger is taken into distributed P2P networks, and the distributed P2P networks gives some more extra credibility to this immutable ledger. It gives something extra security. So we will see what it is. So let's dive into the concept of distributed P2P network. So in a distributed P2P network, we have so many computers and they all are interconnected with each other. So even though if every computer doesn't have a direct link with the other, they have a path to share information with each other. So you can see if there is no direct path between this computer and this computer, but they have this intermediate role which can be used to share information, right? So basically, in a typical point of view, this is a distributed P2P network. So these all are the peers in the network, the information. So what is used in our blockchains? So let's see. So blockchain is actually copied across all the computers. Instead of keeping it in, as we have seen previously, we are keeping that ledger in only one database, right? So instead of putting in one, by using this P2P network, every peer downloads the whole ledger. So let's say the same scenario happens and you want to buy a house. Now a transaction triggers, right? So a block will be added. So every peer in the network adds your new transaction. Remember the poker game which we have seen, everybody writes everybody notes the transaction in the sheet of paper, right? So like that only every transaction, every peer happens. So please give me 1 minute. So give me a second, please.
Yes, so participants, I think you are facing that noise disturbances, right? We are working on it. Just let us wait for 5 to 10 minutes, not more than that. Let us wait for 5 minutes. So meanwhile, if you have any queries till now, whatever Kaushik has explained till now, right, you can just post them in the chat box. He will be responding to your questions. Meanwhile, he will be adjusting his voice and all that noise disturbances, he will be rectifying it. So just give him 5 minutes so that he'll get back to you again. So meanwhile, you can just ask your queries. Please be patient. I know, don't leave the session yet. There are many more interesting concepts yet to be discussed, and moreover, there are 2 more days left. So today is just introductory part, right? To make these introductory concepts explained, he have come up with some pictorial representations and also some useful links. So already I have shared a link regarding this hashing algorithm. You can just use that link and play with it for a while. So you can just use that link and you can just try to generate you can just check how the hashes are generated and try to input different length of data and try to check different outputs and different hashes that you are getting. So by then our mentor will be back. Meanwhile, I'll try summarizing the concept still now. See, like regarding this blockchain, right? Blockchain is simply a link of blocks, like a chain of blocks. We call it as a blockchain. Like, I'll just simply give some simple definitions. So, like, already Kaushik have explained everything in detail, right? I'll just give you a simple definition so that you can understand. So, blockchain is a like a chain of blocks. But how these chains are formed? These chains are formed by these hashes. We call those as hashes, and the other name we can also call it as unique identities. So each block, like a block, is nothing but some data. So each block will have some hash value, that is unique identity, and all the blocks will have some unique identity. And say there are two blocks, block A and block B. So this block B will have its own unique identity, that is its own hash. And also it will have the previous hash. That means the block B will also store the hash value of block A. So in this way, the link is formed between different blocks. So in each block, there will be basically three things. One is data. That is, it can be any data. It can be some random text data, any documents, or it can be any video, audio files. It can be any data. So each data, along with the data, each block will be having some hash, that is unique identity, using which we can access the data from that, using which represents that particular block. And also it will be having previous hash. This previous hash is nothing but the hash, that is unique identity of the previous block, which forms the link between the blocks. I think I made your question clear. Like, Prakash has asked this question regarding this hash algorithm. Hash algorithm will generally generate this hash. So actually Kaushik has explained also some properties of that efficient hash algorithm. So I think you understood enough clearly some basics of like, I've just summarized the things I know. So meanwhile, yes. So you can keep posting your queries. I may not answer all your queries, but when Kaushik rejoins this session, right, I'll just ask him all these questions, and he'll answer all your queries. Meanwhile, you can just go through that link that I have posted earlier, and also post it now. You can just go through that link and you can just play with it for a while. Like, it will it is like a simple demo of this hash algorithm, like wherein you give some random data, it will
come at
random hash.
Is it clear?
Yes, Kaushik. But your voice is too low. You have to be a bit louder, I think. We can hear you, but your voice
is audible.
A bit low. Yes, yes, you are audible and your voice is clear. There is no disturbance, ma'am. But I think your voice has to be raised now. Like, it is a bit low. Yes, yes, yes. We can hear you.
Am I audible, Susha?
Yes, yes, Kaushik, you are audible. Yes.
Yeah, please give me a second, right?
Yes, yes, fine.
Sushant, can you hear me now? So I'm having a technical issue.
Yes, Kaushik, we can hear you now. Yes.
You can see my screen, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay.
So participants, if you can hear Kaushik's voice, you can just type yes in the chat box. So Kaushik, you can just proceed. If you are even facing some problems, participants, you can just let them know. Let him know. Okay. Thank you. Kaushik, you can proceed now.
So I have some questions like if any changes happens in block in the ace hash, changes and that time there is an any automatic indication will be given. So we you will get the this question. I will give you this this question answer in the next session. Once you have seen the whole network how the system works, you will get to know there will be no automatic indication when the hash changes. Okay. So why distributed P2P network is used in blockchain? So that's what I will talk now. So okay, let's proceed. So you got a basic understanding of what is a distributed P2P network, right? So there will be so many peers and they are all interconnected to share information between them. So if there is no direct link between any two nodes, there will be a path between them so they can share information. So that is basically a distributed P2P network. So how blockchains uses this distributed P2P network is, so every peer in the network downloads the whole immutable ledger we have seen before. So instead of keeping it in one database, so every peer maintains a whole ledger. So now once a transaction happens, like we say we bought a house, right? So the transaction is appended to the blockchain by every peer. So not only one peer adds that block, so every peer adds that block to the blockchain. So all these peers maintain a unique blockchain. They doesn't vary in the blocks, right? So the last block here will be same as the last block here. You can see my pointer, right? Let me move my pointer. You can see my pointer, right? Red pointer, Susha.
Yes, we can see it.
So once the transaction happens, every node in the network appends the block. Appends the block in the blockchain. So what happened after some time? There will be more transactions and there will be more blocks added, right? So remember the previous scenario where the hacker comes and want to change the data in this block. Yeah. So what happens? The cryptographic link will be broken, right? As we have seen in the immutable ledger concept. So while we change some data, the hash of the block changes, right? So the cryptographic link changes. So what this attacker should do? He should change the previous hash of this block. So if he change any data in this block, so the whole hash will be changed. So there will be a broken link between these two blocks. So he should change every block in the blockchain. So let's say your house is worth of 1 crore rupees and it is worthwhile for him to do the attack. So he chooses to attack all the blocks. So he is getting 1 crore, right? So why he want to miss the opportunity? So he decides to hack all the blocks. He decides to modify the hash of all the blocks so that there will be no broken link in the blockchain. So let's say he tried to change all the blocks. So this is a P2P network, right? They all, these peers shares information between them. So what happens here is these peers update blockchain. They are all synced with each other. So they are constantly checking that their blockchains match up with each other. So the remaining nodes, now what happens here, the data changes, right? So other nodes will see that there is an issue with this node. So the remaining nodes points that error and says, hey, your blockchain is not right because you should change something. There is something wrong with your chain. So because there are so many computers, right? Because these have majority of the blockchains, correct? So they decide, so this blockchain is not correct, ours is correct. So what they do, what this blockchain do, what this peer will do is, so he thinks something is wrong with my blockchain, so it is not correct, it is not, I am not syncing with other peers. So he downloads the blockchain data with other peers. They interact with other peers and say something is, he tells, hey, something is wrong with my blockchain. So please share the legit blockchain for me. So with, they share, these peers share their blockchain. So he copies all the legit information. So now the hacker should again do the process, right? So if he do keep doing again, but these all other nodes will give information for this blockchain, the legit information. They all say, they all rely upon one blockchain, right? So this synchronization happens in within fraction of seconds. So even when your eye blinking is happening, the synchronization will be done. One second, please. Yeah, okay. I think you all got a how distributed P2P works in blockchain, right? So the hacker can, so this distributed P2P network gave the immutable ledger an extra credibility and an extra layer of security by distributing blockchain into all the peers, right? So as we have seen in the previous example, the blockchain is only in the one centralized database. So if the attacker changes all the blocks in that ledger, so it will be changed, and there will be no need, there is no reverse process to find the original data by seeing the hash, right? So it is a one-way function. So then the attack will be successful. So by keeping this blockchain in a distributed P2P network, so they can decrease the attacks. So there will be no attacker come and change the blocks. So if he want to make a successful attack, so let's say he should change every block in the network. So he should change every blockchain in the network. So which is impossible, right? In blockchain network, there are so many nodes connected in the network, right? So he can't go and change at a time every block and every peer, right? So it gives an extra layer of security. So I got a question whether the hacker also want to hack before the hacker blocks. So I didn't get the question, Mani Bharati. So you can ask me again. I didn't get what you are asking. So, okay. I think all of you got why we use distributed P2P network in blockchain, right? So we don't rely upon one central authority. So as we have seen in the poker game, no central authority or no one friend can't cheat, right? So even if this peer is a malicious peer and he want to change the data, this process is automatic. So all the nodes will change the data. So this process is automatic. This blockchain, this algorithm syncs with other blockchains. So these have majority, right? So let's say this is one peer, there are other five peers, they have majority, right? So this will be the legit blockchain. So here in this case, if the attacker wants to succeed, means so he should at a time hack more than 50% of the nodes, right? So then he will get the majority and they will think our blockchain is wrong and they copies the hacker blockchain. So gaining more than 51% nodes in the network is not a simple task. A hacker cannot do such a thing in a distributed network. So this gives an extra security layer for the immutable ledger. You said that he will hack a block in a blockchain. To get access, he want to hack whole chain, right? Yes, that's what I said about. So if we want to change something in that block, the whole hash will change, right? Remember the avalanche effect. So if he deletes the one record, the whole hash of this block changes. So if this block hash changes, there will be a link between these two blocks, right? This block contains previous hash, which is these two doesn't match, right? Now this hash changes, right? So this link will be broken. So the algorithm maintains that the link should not be broken. You will get all the concepts clear when we see in depth of in the next session how these all things work. So this is the basic overview of distributed P2P network. Okay, I think all of you got an idea of what distributed internet was like. So now let's move on to the other topic called mining. This is an interesting topic and the main concept of blockchain. So we'll see what exactly is mining and so what competition that you can see in uses. There are so many Bitcoin miners and there is so much electricity they are using to mine the blocks. So why they are using that much computation power to mine the blocks? So what exactly this mining process is? We will look into what exactly this mining process. So let's see. This is a small definition of mining. So cryptocurrency mining is the process in which transactions between users are verified and added into the blockchain public ledger. So as we have seen before, if a transaction is triggered, then the block is added, right? So who adds that block? A miner adds that block. So a miner is nothing but who adds new blocks to the blockchain. So simply you can think that those who adds block into the blockchain, so he is a miner. So this is how a mining works. This is how a mining farm looks like. So there are so many GPUs which are running to mine the blocks. Then you can see there is so much computation power they are using to mine a block. We will see why they are using this much computation power to mine a block. So we will see what exactly it is. So this person maintaining the farm is called a miner. So let's see. So the interesting thing in the blockchain is anyone can become a miner because it is a public ledger, public network, right? So anyone can add the network and leave the network, right? So the interesting thing here is anyone can become a miner, but the question is who adds the next block. So if anyone has right to add a block, so they add whatever block they want, and it creates multiple chains in the network, right? So we don't want such kind of system. So we want a single unique blockchain distributed among the nodes in the network. So to tackle this such situation, the networks wants all the miners to participate in a challenge, and the one who wins will be able to add the next block, and the process repeats itself in a loop. So the network gives a task for the miners. So the one who completes the task first will add the block. If a block is added to the blockchain, and again the whole process will loop itself. So we will see what exactly the task is and what it is. Yes, I got a question that why the person will add the block. So why does, yeah, we will see. So why he is doing that mining process and he is spending all that money in computation means by adding block he get a block reward. We will see that in the next sessions. So okay, we will see that in next slides. So here the challenge is a mathematical puzzle, so which requires so much computational power to solve. So they need to use that so many GPUs to supercomputers to mine blocks. It is a mathematical puzzle which can be solved by brute forcing algorithm. So they use so much computation power to brute force a field in the block, which we will talk in the future. So as we have seen block in previous, right? So these are some of the fields in the block. So this is a block number. These have some data. It has a previous hash and it has a hash in it, right? So one second please. Yes, okay. So you can see there are multiple transactions, right? So it's important to note that there will be multiple transactions in a single row. So I didn't mention that point before, right? Okay, so the puzzle here is to find the valid hash of the block. So a miner should find a valid hash of the block. So the question rises here is, we have seen before, if it's so simple to just take this data and send it to a hash function, so we can get a valid hash, right? So give me 1 second, guys. So 1 second, guys, I have give me 1 second. Sushanti, is my voice clear now? Everyone is saying there is noise disturbance. I want response. Am I audible now? Soumya are saying there is a voice disturbance.
Yes, yes. Kaushik, it's better now. You can just continue.
Okay. Where we are? This is a block, right? So there is a block, there's a data field, there is a previous hash, and there is a hash. So, 1 second, guys. Yeah. So the puzzle is finding the valid hash of the block. So the question rises here is, so if it's so simple to just take the data and send it into the hash function, so we can get a valid hash. So if it is so simple, why they are using so many GPUs, right? We can do it in a half a second by giving this data into a hash function. Yeah, here comes, there is an extra field called nonce. There is an extra field called nonce in the block. So This field is what mining is all about. So this nonce gives us an extra credibility. Now we can manipulate the hash by changing the nonce. So we can't change other fields in the block which gives us false results, right? We cannot change the data, we cannot change block number, so we cannot change previous hash like we have seen before. So we want something to change the hash. So a valid hash means we will see what that valid hash in the next slide. So, but we want something to change in the block so that we can change, we can get different hashes. So remember the avalanche effect, right? By changing the data, the whole value of hash will be changed. So we can get so many hashes by changing the nonce value. Finding the valid hash means finding a nonce, finding a hash starting with a certain number of zeros. So you can see there are 3 zeros, right? So for just remember that finding a valid hash means finding a hash that has a 4 leading zeros like that. Am I audible? Sushant, am I audible?
Yes, Kaushik, you are audible.
Okay. So let's see some about hash, right? So we know that hash is a hexadecimal number. Now let's convert this hexadecimal number into decimal number. So this is a hexadecimal number. So in a hexadecimal system, there will be from 0 to 10, and there will be A, B, C, D, E, F to F. There will be there. So this is a hexadecimal number. So I'm converting this to decimal number. So it gives a 73-digit number. Here I have another hash which has 6 leading zeros. It gives 69-digit number. So why I took this slide means you should keep the point in the mind. By increasing the leading zeros, you will get a less number. Why I'm showing in decimal system means so you can understand better than in hexadecimal system. Yes, you can see that if you increase the leading zeros, the decimal value decreases. So if we identify a hash, we identified a hash is a number. So what does it give us? Why I'm telling this? So it is a number, right? So it has some limit. So we can draw a whole pool of hashes. Let's say this is a whole pool of hashes. This is the smallest one and this is the largest one. So let's say it begins with 000 and it has all the hexadecimal numbers in this pool. Let's imagine there are all hexadecimal numbers in this pool, and the largest one is FFF, which is F is the greatest number in hexadecimal, right? So the largest number will be hexadecimal. So let's think all the hashes are there in this pool. So the puzzle is the network sets a target range for the miners to find a hash below the target level. So let's say the network gave a target up to here. So the miners should find a nonce. By changing the nonce, they will get different hashes, right? They should find a hash below this target. Above this target, the one who finds it first will be the winner, and they will get the right to add block into the blockchain. So that the hash above the target will be rejected. So they are not the winners. The one who gets a hash below the target is the winner. So we are assuming the target here with 4 leading zeros. Remember that the higher you have leading zeros, the target will be the lower. So it is hard to find the next. The lower this line will get. If you have leading 9 zeros, this line will go down and this pool size will go down, right? So it is hard to find a valid hash in this large pool. So we will see some calculations tomorrow how much hard it is to find a north. You will get quite good understanding of why they are using so many GPUs. In day 2 session, I will talk about a concept called nonce range. So there you will get a pretty good understanding of why they are using so many GPUs and so many supercomputers to mine. So now let's imagine the target is the miner should find a nonce with 4 leading zeros. The first miner who finds this nonce will be the winner, and he will add the block. So let's say the mining process is done and I am a miner. So I brute force my nonce, and for 2888 I got a hash between around a range here, and for 1000 I got a hash here, for 300 I got hash here. I am doing this brute force algorithm with my GPU and the supercomputer. So it will be a billion, so many billions of numbers. Billions range, so that's why they need that much computation. But as I told, you will get a clarity in day 2 session when I talk about nonce range and all about that stuff. So let's imagine they are brute forcing the nonce and they are getting different hashes. So the one who gets a hash below this target is the winner. So for 3000, if I get a hash below this target, so this is my golden nonce. If I found that hash before anyone finds in the network, so I will be adding that block to the blockchain. So everyone I will broadcast that block. So everyone, every blockchain in the network will sync that block to their blockchain. So the system is all automatic. So the algorithms runs it. So there is no one person telling that he is a miner and only he should do that. So this is all algorithmic. So the norms, this target is also algorithmic. It based upon how many miners are there in the network. So if there are less miners, the target will be less. If there are more miners competing with each other to find a block, then the difficulty will increases in the process. Okay, I think all of you got a basic idea of what is mining. So if yes, please comment in the chat box. If you have any query, please ask in the chat box. If you want me to repeat the concept, I can repeat. So if you didn't get the concept, I can give a quick overview. Okay. I got clear. The concept is clear. So to summarize, what a miner does is simply he brute forces the nonce field and he finds different hashes. So there will be a puzzle for the miners. So the one who found a valid hash first will be the miner who will be adding the block to the blockchain. So that's all. I think this gives a basic overview of what mining is. We will see in depth in the day 2 session. So let's go get into an interesting concept called Byzantine fault tolerance. So it is not only important in blockchain. It is important in any other distributed networks. Okay. Someone says just come again with an answer. Okay. A nonce is nothing but a field. It's an extra field in the block. So as we have block member data and previous session hash, like that it is a field in the block. So what gives is it gives an extra credibility to the miners so that they can change the nonce and they can produce so many different hashes for that block. So by they cannot change data, block member or previous session hash, right? Yes. Yeah, I am explaining about nonce. Yeah, a nonce is nothing but a field. So the miners will manipulate the nonce to get different hashes. So the network will give a puzzle to them. So they should find a valid nonce, a valid hash below the target. So what they will do is they simply changes the nonce. They brute force the nonce. They remember the avalanche effect. Why I am telling is. So they are changing the data in the blockchain. So if they change the nonce means they are changing the data in the block. So the whole hash of the block will be changes. So they will be generating different hashes. So like that, by doing that process, the first miner who gets a hash below the given target, so he will be the winner. He will be the winner of that round. So if he is a winner, so he has that credibility to add the block to the blockchain. So why he will do that means by doing that, if I am a winner in one round, I will get some amount of incentive from that network. We'll see that incentives in day 2 session. So you will get an idea of why they are doing this much competition. You will understand once I have gone into in depth of mining in day 2 session, which I will be telling in tomorrow. Okay, I think you all got a overview of how mining works. So now it is clear, right? What is a nonce? It's just a field miners can manipulate to get different hashes. That's it. That's what nonce is about. I think it is clear, right? Yes, okay. I got it. Okay. So now let's move into a concept called Byzantine fault tolerance. So this is important concepts in blockchain. Not only blockchain, any distributed networks, this is an important concept. So let's look at this Byzantine fault tolerance concept. So for this, we should I will tell you a story which gives you a overall understanding of this concept. Why I am taking this concept instead? This is a distributed network concept where we use. But why I am introducing is for our next consensus protocol, we should understand this how a distributed network handles a such kind of difficult situations. So let's see the story. The story goes that a long, long time ago, there was a castle which the Byzantine Empire wanted to attack and take over. So these are the there are four generals. They want to attack the castle. So, but the thing is, they can only win if the majority of them come to a consensus, or in fact, whether they want to attack or retreat. So the majority of generals should come to an agreement to either attack or retreat. So it will be like if three generals says attack, so majority generals are saying attack, right? So then they will attack and they will win. If three generals says retreat, so majority of them are retreating, so they will be fine. There is no attack, there is no loss for them. So if there is a chaos between them and they didn't come to an agreement, then the enemy will destroy them. So there will be chaos between them, so they don't know what to do. So they don't attack or they don't retreat means they have a loss here, right? So if they retreat, there is no loss. If they attack, they will get damaged. So the point here is they should come to an agreement. So they will be in four sides of the castle, right? So they should talk with each other, they should communicate with each other. So, and they should get to an agreement on what to do. So either we should attack or retreat. So let's say this commander is this general is the commander. So let's assume there is a threat. Okay, so they can communicate with each other with some source. I am not going to tell that. So let's imagine they can communicate with cell phones or something, any other source. There is a messenger who is roaming from this direction to this direction passing information. So let's say there is a traitor in these three generals. These generals don't know whether there is a traitor or not. So because they should trust them, right? So if one got a doubt there is a traitor, how he handles that situation? Okay, so the question is, how do they come up with an algorithm like a consensus that will help them to come to a decision despite there being a traitor? So if there is a traitor also, they should come up with a solution to agree upon something. Either should they attack or victory. So let's have a look how they do that. Yeah. Let's say our commander tells this general and these three generals to attack. So the green arrow represents attack and the red arrow represents retreat in my pictures. So let's say the commander tells the three generals to attack. Now they can be a traitor, right? So how this commander come to an agreement on how this commander come to an agreement, we will see how this comes. So what he will do is they will exchange their information. So this commander tells that, hey, this general tells that, hey, commander told me to attack. So he passes this information to this general also, attack. So this general says, yes, commander also told me to attack. So he will share this information with these other two generals. So he is a traitor, right? He can tell anything. Let's say he told, obviously he will manipulate and he will bring chaos, right? So he will tell that, hey, my commander told me that we should retreat. So we should retreat. So now let's say this general got someone said to attack and someone said to retreat. There is a chaotic situation. So how he will come to an agreement now? Simply here he takes the majority of messages. So here you can see that there is a one green arrow that says that commander commander says that to attack. So there is another green arrow for him pointing towards him. The pointing towards him means he is receiving that message, right? So there is another message called attack. But traitor gives one message a retreat. So how he comes up with a decision either to attack or retreat, right? So he calculates those three receiving messages and he takes the majority decision. So he got two attack and one retreat upon three, right? So obviously he will go with attack. So he should somehow agree on something, right? Rather than just sitting like that, the enemy will come and kill him. So he should make an agreement. So he should make a decision. So he takes a majority decision. So like that, what this commander also do? They will all agree upon this decision before going to attack the castle, right? So he will also do the same. He will take his three received messages and he will calculate the majority of the messages. So he got two attacks in out of three. So he got a majority for attacking. So this general also attacks. So commander also attacks. So these three will attack. If he is a traitor, if he either attacks or retreats, we don't know what he will do. So, but as I told previously, so three sides, there is an attack going on the castle, so they can win right now. So the situation is handled because they agreed in advance so that we should take a decision by taking a majority of the receiving messages, right? So they agreed and there is no chaotic situation. They handled that chaotic situation and they won the battle. So there is no loss for them for being an attacker. Let's say now a situation comes up where the commander is an attacker. He is a traitor. Let's imagine the situation where the commander tells one general attack, two generals attack and one general retreat. So what these generals will do? Again they share information between them, right? So he tells that commander told me to attack, commander told me to attack. So he tells that he got a retreat message, right? So here the traitor is coming. So he tells I got a retreat message. So this guy tells that I got an attack message. So how they will come and agree? How they will take a decision in this chaotic situation? So exactly as I told before. So they will take the receiving messages and they will agree upon the majority of the decisions. So and once again this general takes. Once again this general takes the majority of decisions, majority of receiving messages. So he got one attack, two attack and one retreat. So out of three he got two members they told him to attack. So he will rely upon attack. So what this guy will do? So he got one attack, two attack and one retreat from the traitor. So the majority is attack, right? So he will also attack. So what this guy will do? Again same. He got one attack, two attack, one retreat. So he got two, right? So these three will attack. Whether the commander attacks or retreats doesn't matter, because by attacking three sides of the castle, as we have talked before, they will win. They will take over the castle. They can win the battle, right? So let's say there are two traitors. So how to handle this situation? Is there a way to handle that chaotic situation if there are two traitors? So let's say let's imagine there are two traitors. There is no way to handle that situation, right? So if they take up majority, they will get majority false messages. So they can't rely on that. If they rely on that, so the traitors will go off and these two will attack and they lost the match. They lost the battle, right? So the point here is there should be more than 33%. There should not be more than 33% trading situation if we take 100%. So there is more than 33% trading probability, so they will get erected. One second. Yes. So what level is it tolerant? So more than 1/3 cannot be traded. I hope all of you got a concept of why I'm telling this concept means this is a very, very hard problem in computer systems or any distributed networks. It has so much research study on about Byzantine fault tolerance, how to come to a consensus in a distributed network. So it is a very hard problem. I explained with the two examples, whether a commander is general, commander is traitor or other general is traitor, to get you a flavor of how things, how they will agree in a distributed networks when there is a chaotic situation. So we will see, you will get to understand of why I am telling this concept right now when we go to consensus protocol, how we use this agreement system in blockchain, and how that is a distributed network, right? How we come to a consensus and how we decided to which miner to add a block and how they will come to a consensus. Okay, I think all of you got a basic idea of what I'm talking about Byzantine fault tolerance, right? So if yes, please let me know in the chat box. If you have any queries in this concept, please let me in the chat box. I can tell you. So the important thing to note is how they are coming to a consensus, an agreement in a distributed system, right? So let's take these general sense computers and how if there is a hacker in the four members, how they agree upon the things. So there is no central authority maintaining everything in distributed networks, right? So they should rely upon themselves. So how they will come to an agreement is the point we are going to talk. Okay, yeah, I got this understood. So there is a research paper on Byzantine fault tolerance. This paper is written by Leslie Lamport, Robert Shostak, and Masterpiece. If you have free time, you can read this paper. It gives a more clear understanding of how things work in distributed networks. So the link will be shared by Sushant in the description, so you can see that. Okay. So now let's go into the other concept called consensus protocol. So we will see what this consensus protocol and how it is used in blockchain. So I have talked about consensus protocol in the previous when I'm talking Byzantine fault tolerance, right? So consensus means nothing but coming to an agreement. So in a distributed network, coming to an agreement. So in terms of consensus protocol, we are going to look at the challenges that they are designed. So because we already got familiar with the concept right before when we are talking about Byzantine fault tolerance. So we understand whole notion of how distributed networks agree on things. So in our case, it is how does it agree on how to keep growing, how to keep adding the blocks. So we have seen that. Okay, no doubt. Yeah. So we have seen that a miner adds a new block. So anyone can become a miner. So how they will agree upon who to add a block if there are two miners who got an on set time. Quite a valid question. We will see that in those situations how they will handle. In our case, the consensus protocol has to solve two main challenges in blockchain. So the first one is protecting the network from the attackers. So this is our distributed network, right? So the challenge one is how to protect from the attackers by using this consensus level. We already talked about an attacker attacking a block in the middle of the chain. Right before when we talking about immutable ledger concept, so which is highly impossible. So the problem we are talking is what happens if the attacker tries to put a block at the end of the chain. Means if the miner is malicious and he got the valid hash and he is trying to put a malicious block at the end. So what if the miner is like that? What if the commander is traitor, right? So what happens if the miner is a fault miner? He is a malicious miner, so he want to keep, he want to add malicious transactions, right? So if he won the valid hash, so he has the right to add the block, right? So how we will tackle this situation in this kind of scenario? So the network, so as I told, the network will give some reward for the miner for mining the block, right? So unless he doesn't do that much computation for, if he doesn't get any profits, right? So he will get some profits by doing that computation work. So he is contributing to the network, right? So he will get the network will use some incentive in cryptocurrency for the miner. So and the transaction fees are also collected with the transactions, and the transaction fees also get for the miner. We will talk about what the transaction fee in our day 2 session and day 3 session in depth, so you can understand what a transaction fee is. So this financial incentive for miners makes them to mine, right? So and also there is a financial incentive for miners to play fair because they put in a lot of work. So to find the nonce, right? So they put in a lot of work, they get so much electricity bill, right, by doing that so many GPUs computation power to finding a nonce. So let's say if they put a lot of work and then the miner add a block that is rejected because of including malicious transactions, then they won't get that reward, right? So if other nodes reject that this block is not a valid block, these transactions are manipulated by the miner, so if they reject it, means he cannot add that block to the blockchain. Means he doesn't get that incentive which the network is giving because he is a malicious miner, right? He doesn't get that incentive, so he doesn't do something like stupid. If any stupid miner is there, he can do which gives me so much electricity bill and he got so much losses. So the miner doesn't do that work because he get only loss, right? He doesn't get anything profit with them. So they don't want to risk that, so that they have to play fair. And how will the network know if they are adding a malicious block? That's an important question we should ask ourselves, right? So it's simple. Every node before adding the block, they will conduct a series of checks. Here are some series of checks screenshots. There are some series of checks that a miner, that a node or a peer which maintains the ledger will run through that block while adding it, while copying that block to his chain. So we can see that they are verifying the Merkle hash. So they are seeing the timestamp. They are seeing that transaction list must not be empty, right? So there are so many these checks they will do to add a block to the blockchain. So if one check fails, means that it is a malicious block, so they will reject the block. So if all the nodes reject that block, so the miner doesn't get that incentive for him. He will do so much work putting so much electricity and so much work on finding the valid hash, and he once in 100 times he got a golden nonce and he got a valid hash and he has a right to add the block, so that he will get some incentive. So no miner will ever do that malicious transactions, and they don't add malicious transactions in the block because the block will be rejected by other miners. So there will be if one node is a miner, all of them will be verified at that time. So they will verify the block, and they will run an algorithm simply. They just don't go and see that this is the automatic process. If the verification fails, they simply reject the block. So if all the nodes in the network reject the block, so the miner doesn't get that incentive for him. So there will be a loss for the miner. So one thing to keep in mind is cryptographic puzzles are hard to solve, easy to verify. So you should keep this point in the mind. As we have seen that nonce puzzle, it's a cryptographic puzzle, right? They are changing the hash to get, they are changing the nonce to get a valid hash. So it is hard to solve, but easy to verify. It means every miner, every other node in the network can easily verify. For verification, they will take at least 1 second or half second. That's it. So, but to solve that puzzle, it's very hard to solve. He should keep so much GPUs and CPUs, and he costs so much electricity, right? So cryptographic puzzles are hard to solve and easy to verify. So, okay, I think all of you got an overview of how network nodes agree upon things while an attacker is when a miner is an attacker and adding a block in at the end of the chain, right? So if you got the concept clear, please let me know in the chat box. Yes, I got an S. Okay. So what if the verifier is a front? You will understand that when I go into the concepts in depth in session 2. So verifier also, in reality, verifiers also get a small amount of reward for them. So they which motivates them to do the right thing. So majority cases, there will be so many nodes, right? So the verification will be quite legal. They will do the correct verification for that instant too. So if the verifiers are wrong, there will be some penalty in some networks, and in some other blockchains there will not, depends upon the which blockchain they are using. So for verifiers also, there will be some penalty when doing such a false verification. So that concepts are so hard to tell you in one lecture. So let's try to understand the verifiers will verify correctly right now. Okay. So we have talked about the consensus should solve two major problems, right? We have seen the one. The second challenge is that the consensus protocol should solve the problem of competing chains. So what is this problem of competing chains? So we will see that in the next slide. So let's say here is a one miner. He is in USA and this miner is in India. So they all are bit forcing the nonce and trying to find a valid hash, and say at the same time, this miner got a valid hash and this miner also got a valid hash. So there is nothing wrong, right? So he adds a block, he doesn't change any transactions, he is not a malicious miner. So simply he adds a block at the end of the chain. So here the Indian miner also adds a block at the end of the chain. So what they will do after adding the block, they will broadcast the block to the network, right? So other nodes in the network also copies from the nearest peer. So let's say for this miner, broadcasting is so fast, and there are three miners who copied that blockchain, right? So let's say that this Indian miner has less broadcasting network, so only one miner copied this chain. So here you can see that there are two chains. There is a purple chain and there is an orange chain. So these two different chains in the network. So we are getting two chains like that. If again this situation happens, we will get four different chains. We will get eight. There will be a two multiplier, right? So we don't want that system. So we want a unique blockchain which is distributed among networks. So they should keep syncing it. So they should rely upon only one blockchain. So which blockchain they decides to be a valid one. So what they do to come up an agreement, so they can agree upon one blockchain, either an orange one or purple one. So here you can see that there is a similar problem like present and fault tolerance, right? So they should agree upon either any of the one, either attack or retreat, like the situation. They got an orange chain or a purple chain. So, but in the blockchain, what we will do is we are going to wait until another block is mined and added. So the when this chaotic situation comes in network, so these nodes will wait for some time so that another block, another miner adds finds a valid hash and he adds another block. So they will wait for that time, and once the block is added, then we will see which of the two chains is longer. So the saying in the blockchain is the longest one is the valid node. So every node in the network maintains agrees upon the longest chain in the network. So if their chain is smaller than the other chain, they will go and simply copy that blockchain. So because it is the longest, it is the valid chain. So if the protocol is defined like that, so the longest chain will be the valid chain. So the longest chain replaces the other chains. So the point here is the part of the network that has the highest hashing power will add the next block, right? So you can see this. There are four miners in this orange blockchain, right? So in this purple, there are two miners. So compared to from orange and purple, they have twice number of hash power, right? There are so many members. So these four members are computing, trying to find a valid hash. But these two are also competing. But when it comes to we can statistically speaking, we can tell that a majority only orange miners will get the next block, right? So statistically speaking, there is a more than half probability, right? So let's say this orange miners found a block and they added to the chain. So now what's the rule? This is the longest chain. So everyone should switch to longest chain. So they waited until now. They are going to see which block is who are minting the block, who are appending the block. So they will get a longest chain. So they can switch to that chain. So there should be no two competing chains, right? So they should agree upon which chain they should sync with. So this is a type. This is what means consensus. They should come up with a consensus algorithm. So the algorithm here is they should rely upon the competing chains. They should rely upon the largest chain in the network. So they wait until the next block is mined and they will sync with this blockchain because it has no 1, 2, 3. It has 10 blocks, right? Remaining all has 9 blocks. So they will sync with this blockchain. So these four will add to this blockchain, and these two nodes also will take the purple block, and these two add that orange blockchain. So now they come up with a solution. They had an agreement, and they maintained a single blockchain, which solves the problem of the competing chains, right? So there should be only one chain in the network. So there should not be two different chains or three different chains. So this consensus protocol, the protocol is that agree upon the longest chain, balances that, it gives the extra credibility for the miners to come to an agreement in the distributed network. Right? So like that, like this way, they will come to an agreement and there will be only blockchain. So the consensus protocol solves the issue of competing chains. So what happens to these two purple blocks? It means they are called orphan blocks. So the transactions will be again reverted, and they go into a memory pool, which miners, they go into miners pool, and the miners again pick the transactions and again add it to the next block. So they can add to the new block. So these transactions will be again mined by the miner. So the incentive here will be regained. So the miner here doesn't get incentive. So there is a catch here. He is doing a great work, and he is doing nothing wrong, but he is doing a legit work, and he doesn't get incentive. But sometimes it happens to rely upon a consensus, to rely upon an agreement. So they should do some sacrifices like this, right? We will see how these all things work under the hood in the day two session. You will get a complete overview of when we talk about non-stranger, how miners pick transactions in the blocks. You will get a whole overview. Now I am giving a whole overview. You will get a whole clarity when I tell all those concepts. So there are different types of consensus protocols like proof of work, proof of stake, as we have seen Bayesian and fault tolerance. There is a algorithm called practical Bayesian and fault tolerance. So there are so many. You can see that we have talked about proof of work. When we talked about miner, so proof of work means they should show a proof that they have done some work. So what you can see, I have told that previously, right? So the miners should do some work. They should solve a puzzle. They should do some electricity. They should do some work, and they should solve the puzzle. And he is showing that I got a valid NOS. I have done some work. So this is my proof. So this is my proof of work. So the cryptocurrency mining is nothing but proof of work consensus algorithm. So the miners show the work they have done, and they get the credibility to add the block, so that they will get the incentive from the network, so that he will get some profit with it. So we talked about proof of work algorithm. So Bitcoin uses proof of work algorithm. So there is another algorithm called proof of stake. I'm not going to tell about all these consensus protocols because the session will be lengthy. So you can go and search in the internet about proof of work and Byzantine fault tolerance and practical Byzantine fault tolerance. You can search what are the different types of consensus protocols in the internet. You will get a list and you will get some blocks on them. You can read them, right? So we talked about is proof of work algorithm, which is Bitcoin. You will see this proof of work in detail in the third session. I hope all of you got an idea of consensus protocols, right? So if yes, if you have any queries, please let me know in the chat box.
Yes, Kaushik, give me a minute. Okay. So yes, you can hear me, right?
Yes, I can hear you.
So I have posted the feedback link of today in the chat box. So I request all the participants to fill that feedback form. And also in that feedback form, like for this particular workshop, right, we have around 5 associate partners, like 5 colleges. So if you got invitation from any of those colleges, right, you do select that college name. Like the feedback link, I have mentioned a question saying, have you got to know about this workshop? So if you got the invitation from any of those colleges, right, then select that particular college's answer for that question. And if not, like if you are earlier a student of Skill2Hire, like earlier a user of Skill2Hire, and you got to know by notifications or something related to Skill2Hire people, then you select for Skill2Hire, or else go with the college name that you got the invitation from. So having said this, I hope all the participants will fill the Google form. And yes, Kaushik, you can just respond to those queries. And one more point, and subscribe to our YouTube channel, because tomorrow again we will be streaming this live on only YouTube. So to get that instant notification, you have to be subscribed to our YouTube channel and also click on that bell icon so that you'll get that instant notification. And also we'll be hosting many free such webinars and workshops. So to get notifications on each and every webinar that we host, do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Yes, Kaushik, you can go with the queries.
Okay, I got a question that every miner should stick for the single chain in the network. Am I correct? Yes, they should stick with the single chain, right? So when there are competing chains, they should agree on one chain. So which chain they will agree means they will wait for the next block to be mined, and they will see which miner mines the next block. So he will get the longest chain. So they all sing that longest chain and they remove that other orphan blocks, like we have seen the purple one, right? So they will just remove that block from the chain. So there will be orphan blocks. So they will again go to the miner, and the miner again pick those transactions, and he will mine those transactions again. So like that, they will come to come to this. So they come to upon an agreement saying they should maintain. So we should have only single chain, right? So if you have a distributed database and if you have some data in one database and you have different data in other database, it doesn't make any sense, right? So there should be a uniqueness in the data, right? If I have a Facebook account, I have a Kaushik here in my mobile, and if my laptop is accessing another database, I should not see another name, right? So I should see the exact Kaushik name in my Facebook account, right? So in the case of distributed network also, they should agree, they should maintain a unique chain, right? So they should come up with an agreement. So that's what these consensus protocols solve. The algorithm gives extra credibility to rely upon, which, so what to agree upon and which to agree upon. So I think all of you got a basic overview. So these are the topics covered. To summarize, so everybody can see my screen, right?
Yes, Kaushik, definitely.
Okay. We have talked about what is blockchain, right? Before we have talked about what is blockchain. We have seen that poker game definition. I have given. It is not a quite good example, but you got a basic idea of how things work, right? So the main thing there is no centralized authority maintaining anything. So everything is distributed and open source. So we have talked about SHA-256 algorithm, the five requirements of the SHA-256 hash function. So it is a one-way function, right? You cannot predict the input by seeing the output. So it gives a fixed length string for anything data. It is a fast computation. It is deterministic. We have seen all those features in the SHA-256 function, right? So we have seen how that SHA-256 is used in the blockchain concept to form a cryptographic link so that it can form an immutable ledger, right? So we have seen how P2P networks give an extra layer of security for that immutable ledger, as we have seen in that example when we are discussing about P2P networks, right? So we have seen how mining works and how the miner come up with a valid hash by changing the nonce. We have seen the process of mining, right? So the process of mining is nothing but a miner should mine a block, like a gold mining. Is the concept of generating new currency comes with mining. Only the currency will generate when the block is mined in Bitcoin network. For example, I am taking Bitcoin network. So the new Bitcoins will be released in the process of mining. So in gold also, the new gold will come in the process of mining, right? So so the names come up like that. So why they named it is mining base, so that's why new Bitcoins or new cryptocurrencies comes up in the process of mining. So the incentive they are getting is the new cryptocurrency generated in the network, the new incentive generated. So that's why the mining name is, right? So we have seen Byzantine fault tolerance concept. We have seen a story upon Byzantine Empire, by how they are attacking and how they are agreeing if there is a traitor, if there is a chaotic situation, how they are coming to an agreement, right? So we have seen that Byzantine fault tolerance. We have seen consensus protocols, how network peers in the network of the blockchain, how peers in the network maintains the blockchain, right? So if there are competing chains or if there is a malicious miner who is trying to add a block at the end of the chain, right? So how they come up to an agreement, right? So if a malicious miner acts, the consensus protocol is to every node will verify some checks before adding the block. So to prevent the attackers, that is a protocol. So to prevent the competing chains, we have seen that longest chain will be the valid chain, right? So the miner who adds a new block first, who has the longest chain, that is a valid chain, to agree upon that chain. So like that, they agree upon one thing and they maintain a single chain. So I hope all of you got an understanding of all these seven concepts, right? So if there is any doubt, please let me know in the chat box. I want to go to that previous website which we have seen, that Andrew Brownworth website, right? So I want to go to that website and show you what we have discussed in that website using some tools which was given by Andrew Brownworth. So I'm going to that website. I will share the screen. Give me a second. Sushant, can you see my screen?
Yes, Kaushik, you can see.
Okay. Yeah, we have seen this hash function, right, before. So there are other fields here. So there is a field called block. Let's go into that. We have seen that, right? The block contains a block number, a nonce field, and a data. So they gave a nice main button to, let's say, I wrote a transaction like A sends to B 0.5, and I mine that block. You can see there is a hash. This is a simple demo. It's not a virtual blockchain, so that's why the mining process is so fast. So you can see there are four leading zeros here, right? That means the miner got a valid hash, and the red color changes into green, right? So it's a valid one. So this is what a block is. The main fields in the block are the block number, the nonce, the data which represents all the transactions in the block, and the current hash and the previous hash. So right here there is no previous hash because it's a single block, right? So we will go into blockchain. So there are multiple blocks, right? This is an immutable ledger which we have seen before. Currently there is no data. Let's say I have added something like this. I have added my name. I have tampered with this chain, right? So in the middle, I have tampered this data. So you can see that the previous hash here will be changed, right? So the link will be changed. The link will be broken. So all these blocks got read, right? So what I should do is I should mine this block. If I change the data, right, I should mine this block. So I got a hash like 0000 DAC4. So this previous, I should mine this block also, right? I should change this block also. It should also have this previous hash, right? So it is, I should mine this block. I should change this block also. I should change this block also to get. So it is so simple to mine here, but in reality they are using so much computation power, right? So on demo purpose, we are using this website given by Andrew Brownworth. It's taking some time to mine. Okay, it's mine, right? So tampering with immutable ledger is this one. This is the immutable ledger, right? So to tamper that, he should change all the blocks. He should again remind the blocks, and he should append that to the blockchain. So it is a hard task in reality, but for the demo purpose, I have. So let's see a distributed P2P network. What we have seen, right? So here are this is a peer here maintaining a ledger. And here is a PRP maintaining a ledger. Sushant.
Yes, Kaushik. Yes.
I think you can switch off your mic.
Okay.
Here is a PRC which maintains a ledger. So, as we have seen, if I change something here, I have something like, I should change all this, right? Even if I change all this, I'm not going to press mine button. So I think it is taking some time process. So you can see Sushant will give the, have given the link before, right? So you can go to the website and you can play around with this and you can get a flavor of what we have discussed today. So you can go around and play with this tool, right? So if so, here in distributed peer network, if an attacker can change all the blocks in the PDA, but he should change the PRB also, right? He should change the PC. Like that, he should change more than 50% of the blockchains in the network, right? So he should manipulate more than 50%, 51% of nodes in the stream in the network. So it is pretty hard to do that. So since it is since he should compute all the, he should do so much computation work, so it doesn't give any incentive for him. It's a waste of time for doing that. So the system is maintained like that. So why this system is so important means there is no central authority maintaining. But even if there is a distributed network, the agreeing upon by using a consensus algorithm is so different. These concepts didn't came before blockchain technology. So these are pretty hard concepts to apply in the computer science before blockchain technology came in 2009, right? So it's so powerful. It opens doors for so many industries like healthcare, which we can show publicly data, right? Without a trustless environment. In a trustless environment also, trustless environment means like we have seen Byzantine fault tolerance. They cannot trust with each other. He cannot trust another general, but he came up with an agreement, right? So which made them to attack or retreat, right? So in a trustless environment also, they are agreeing upon things. And these concepts raise it opened so many doors in the technologies. It disrupted the whole industry like healthcare, supply chain management. So we will talk about them in near future. If we talk, we can make another sessions on different blockchains where we can see how blockchain disrupts the industry like that. So you can go around and play with this website. You can see here there is a tokens section. It is nothing but a P2P distributed P2P network, but it has some transactions. You can change this transaction. If you change this transaction, you can change all these transactions. It's a similar one, but it has some tokens in it. It has some transactions in it. So you can play with this website. Here is a Coinbase, which we will talk about this Coinbase section, session 2. Nothing but simply, it's a miner fee, miner getting the fee, right? The miner will get some incentive, right? That is the Coinbase fee. Okay, I think all the concepts are pretty clear for you. You can go around and play with this website. So Sushant, you can post this link in description once again so that everyone will go around and see the website. I think everyone got a pretty good idea, right? So if you have any queries, please ask in the chat box. I will make sure to answer them.
So we are already out of time, but we are waiting for queries actually. So if you have any queries, you can just post us in the chat box. So if you don't have any queries, you can just start leaving, and so that we can just end this session. So if you have any queries, feel free to post those in the chat box. And I sincerely thank our associate partners for this 3-day workshop on blockchain and Bitcoin fundamentals. And also I sincerely thank all the participants for being patient. And I think there was some disturbance regarding this noise disturbances, right? So tomorrow there will be no such issues. We'll be coming up with some solution. So there will be no such issues in the tomorrow's session. So make sure to join the session at 6 p.m. And to get the notifications, do subscribe our YouTube channel. And I think, Kaushik, there are no more queries left.
Yeah.
Yes, we have to end this session.
We can end this session.
Yes, thank you, Kaushik, and thank you all the participants and also our associate partners. Thank you for your patience and thank you for your presence. Yes, you can work on these concepts. Yes, good Hari Krishnan. You can work on these concepts and you can come up with the questions in tomorrow's session. So you can just work on these topics again. You can just revise all those topics anyhow. The video will be present in our YouTube channel. You can again go through our video so that you can find some more questions and get back, join back tomorrow's session with some questions. So thank you all. Yes, thank you.